I'll turn over to 422 this morning. Surely goodness and mercy, 422. Father, Lord, we love and praise you. Thank you for this day. Thank you for everything you do, Father, for all the people in Mississippi. Lord, we just ask that you just be with them and their families, Father, through all those tornadoes and everything that's happened, Father. And we just thank you for everything you do for us, Lord, and just bless us and be with us this morning, Father, and just help us to get out of your way and just to open up our hearts and minds, Father, and be receptive to what you have to say this morning, Father, and just give Brother Ken the words that you'd have spoken to each and every heart, Father. We love and praise you. In Jesus' sweet name I pray. Amen. Amen. All right, now we'll turn over to 424 this morning, Heavenly Sunlight, 424.
Sunlight all of my journey over the mountains through the deep veil. Jesus has said I'll never forsake thee, promise divine that never can fail. Heavenly sunlight, heavenly sunlight, flooding my soul. Around me, shadows above me, never conceal my Savior and guide. He is the light, in him is no darkness, ever I'm walking close to his side. Heavenly sunlight, heavenly sunlight, flooding my soul with glory divine. Sunlight ever rejoicing, pressing my way to mansions above, singing his praises, gladly I'm walking, walking in sunlight, sunlight of love. Heavenly heavenly sunlight, flooding my soul with glory divine. Hallelujah, I am rejoicing, singing his praises, Jesus is mine.
Amen.
Amen. It's good to welcome you this morning. And so good to see you. And I think the rain has quit for the moment. And so we're appreciate the rain, but we're also glad when we can get in and out of church without it being wet. But it is good to see everybody. We appreciate the flowers this morning in memory of Miss Virginia Johnson from Candy, in memory of her mom. And we appreciate you doing that and appreciate what y'all do every week. Please don't forget to sign up to put an Easter lily in for Easter Sunday if you would like. Sign up in the foyer. Please note that we will have the Lord's Supper next Sunday, and then we will have sunrise service with breakfast on Easter Sunday. Easter is April the 9th. I don't know why, but it seems like Easter's still a month away, but it's not. But make sure you make a note of that, and we'll always have a good time there. Then you see the other stuff that's coming up. Please, we announced this last week. We're asking for your help in picking a color for the carpet and pews, and we'll present the recommendation on the 16th during conference, but we're asking those that are here, if you would, to take one of these cards and circle one or two and put your name on it. Please don't vote for no. If somebody asked me the other day if they could vote for somebody that doesn't come, and I said, no, you got to come. No proxy voting. And you can only vote one time. But we appreciate your help with this. And we are continuing to take money for the Annie Armstrong Easter offering. If you want to make a check, please make sure you write the check to the church and don't write it to something else, but write it to the church. Just make a note on the check what it's for, and then we appreciate that. We've received $415 so far, and our goal this year is $1,000. We have several to remember for prayer. I want to remember all these on our prayer list. Want to remember, of course, the folks in Mississippi that were hit so hard with the tornadoes. Remember Karen's dad, Charles Wellum. He's at Douglas General and improving slowly. Karen said he was arguing with her today, so that's a good sign. So remember him. Continue to remember Glenn. He's out of the hospital and back home, and just pray that they can get the infection cleared up and it doesn't come back. Good to see Donna English here. Amen. And glad that she's doing good, and remember her, though, as she continues to recover from her heart attack. Remember Joyce. Joyce is going to have surgery on her elbow this Tuesday. Remember her. Remember Paul, he's having some tests run. Remember Miss Phyllis Potts, she's having some issues. And then Karen's also asked us to remember Charles Jackson. They had to take him to the hospital last night, and a possible internal blockage. So remember them. What else do we need to mention for prayer? Anything else?
Remember the nurse that I work with, her son's name is Tremaine. And she's asked us to put him on the prayer list. He's a disabled veteran with some chronic conditions that he incurred while in Iran.
Okay. All right. Tremaine. All right. All right. Any unspoken concerns? All right. Let's pray. Dearly Father, we just thank you for today. We thank you for your goodness and mercy, for the privilege to be here in this place. Lord, we pray for the folks that were hit by the storms the other night, and just pray for them, Lord, and help them as they begin the cleanup process, Lord, and especially those that lost loved ones. Lord, we pray for our country. We pray for the world situation. We pray especially for these on our prayer list and for these we've mentioned and these unspoken concerns. And we pray that, Lord, you might just do what only you can do. Be with us this morning and help us, Lord, to honor you in all that we do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Turn this morning over now to 425, He Keeps Me Singing, 425.
There's within my heart a melody, Jesus whispers sweet and low. Fear not, I am with thee, peace be still, in a love life's ebb and flow. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. All my life was wrecked by sin and strife, discord filled my heart with pain. Jesus swept across the broken strings, stirred the slumbering chords again. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Feasting on the riches of His grace, resting neath the sheltering wing, always looking on His smiling face, that is why I shout and sing. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Though sometimes He leads through waters deep, trials fall across the way. Though sometimes the path seems rough and steep, see His footprints all the way. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Soon He's coming back to welcome me, far beyond the starry sky. I shall wing my flight to worlds unknown, I shall reign with Him on high. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go.
Amen. Now y'all pray for the choir. They're going to do one for y'all this morning called Follow Me. And listen to the words this morning. Sometimes I'm God's whiny little crybaby about life, and it kind of sets me in my place the way I need to have my mind set. So listen to the words this morning to follow me.
Thank you.
the choir. This morning, if you will, turn to Mark chapter 12 for our scripture passage. Mark chapter 12. We're going to read verses 1 through 12. If you found it, if you would please stand as we honor the reading of God's word. And the word of God says, "He began to speak unto them by parables. A certain man planted a vineyard and set a hedge about it and digged a place for the wine fat and built a tower and let it out to the husbandmen and went into a far country. And at the season he sent to the husbandman a servant that he might receive from the husband of the fruit of the vineyard. And they caught him and beat him and sent him away empty. And again he sent unto them another servant. And at him they cast stones and wounded him in the head and sent him away shamefully handled. And again he sent another, and him they killed and many others, beating some and killing some. Having therefore one son, his well-beloved, he sent him also last unto them, saying, They will reverence my son. But those husbandmen said among themselves, This is their heir, come, let us kill him, and the inheritance shall be ours. They took him and killed him and cast him out of the vineyard. What shall therefore the Lord of the vineyard do? He will come and destroy the husbandmen and will give the vineyard unto others. And have you not read in the scripture, The stone which the builders rejected is become the head of the corner. This was the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. And they sought to lay hold on him, but feared the people, for they knew that he had spoken the parable against them. And they left him and went their way." Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your precious word. Thank you for just the opportunity to be here in this place. We're most of all appreciative this morning of the fact that you came to this earth to die on the cross for our sins, and that you rose again on the third day. Lord, just use this passage to encourage us and to draw us closer to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. We're looking at this parable in preparation for the coming of Christ and his death and resurrection, just 2 weeks away. We looked last week at the passage in Luke where he, very early in his ministry, raised the widow from Nain's son and just did something that just totally caught everybody off guard, but he did that in an attempt to prepare them for who he was, but also about what he's going to do. When we get to Mark chapter 12 and this parable that he tells, we need to understand something. This is the last week of Jesus' life. He's already come through Jerusalem on his triumphant entry. In Mark chapter 12, that's on Sunday. By Friday, he's going to be, he will be crucified. Now think about this. We often kid sometimes about when are we going to die and knowing when we're going to die. And I've always said, I really don't want to know when I'm going to die. I just soon it happen. I'd overthink it, and I'd worry and stress over it. But folks, Jesus knew what was coming. He knew. And he's in a he's been in a debate with the religious leaders. If you go back to the last part of chapter 11, they tried to trick him, and they finally asked him, "What authority are you doing this?" Notice at no point does he get frustrated. Notice at no point does he get mad to say, "You know, I came to save y'all, and you don't even understand what I'm doing. I'm tired. I'm done. I'm going home. Forget this." Thank goodness he didn't do that. Amen. But based on that discussion where they're questioning his authority, he tells this parable the last week of his life. And he's speaking it specifically to the religious leaders who in the last part of chapter 11 were questioning his authority, what he was doing, what he was saying. Now, whenever we talk about parables, there's a couple of things we need to understand. We need to understand that a parable is just a story about something very common that people could identify with and relate to, dealing with everyday life. And Jesus used that to try to teach spiritual truth. But we need to understand one thing. We don't need to, as we look at parables, we don't need to overanalyze everything in the parable. We don't need to look at every word and think, okay, what does this mean? What does this point to? Instead, we need to look at the main theme of the parable. We don't need to get so caught up in all of the different parts of the parable that we miss the point of the parable. And Jesus told this parable. He often used parables to kind of hide and disguise what his message was to the religious leaders and others. But oftentimes we know that it often was disguised to his own disciples because they were a little thick and didn't quite understand what he was saying and doing. But we need to understand that when he told this parable, his disciples got it, the ones who heard it got it, and especially the religious leaders that he was telling this against, they got it. It tells the story of a wealthy landowner who decides to build a vineyard. And he goes and he's starting from scratch. There's nothing there. And he goes and he does everything that he needs to do. He prepares the soil. He plants the vines. He builds a wall around it to protect people from stealing, protect it from the animals. And he dug a pit out for the wine press. He made a tower to protect and provide security for this vineyard. He's invested a lot of time and energy and resources in this property. And we need to understand, too, that it's going to take at least 4 years for him to finally get a crop. It's not like he can make an initial investment and think at the end of the year that he's going to get a big return on his money. He's not. It's going to take time. Because of who he is and what all he has going, he has to hire some people to take care of this, to manage it, to be a good steward of this, because he's busy doing other stuff. We're very familiar with this idea. We would call these fellows tenant farmers. There was a time in America, there was a time in the South, and many of us have family members at some point who were tenant farmers. They didn't own the land, they just worked the land, and they harvested the crop, and then they would split and get a small portion of the crop that was produced, and then the owner of the property would get the larger portion. That's exactly what's going on here. But when you have a tenant farmer, they have a lot of freedom in how to manage themselves, but they've got to do what the owner requests of them. Why do they have to do what the owner requests of them? It's his property, right? It's his vineyard. He's in charge, and he's entrusting them to manage this, but ultimately they are responsible to him. He gets everything set in motion. He hires these folks to manage the vineyard. And then after the appropriate time, which again would have been at least 4 years, he sends a servant to go and to get his profit from what they had done, from the harvest that they had collected. And these folks that were supposed to take care of his farm, they had worked very hard, been very diligently, had the the prophet had been very profitable, I believe. But when they saw his servant come, instead of just acknowledging that he was the owner's servant and giving him what was his due, instead they beat him and run him off. I don't know about you, but if you were the owner and you sent someone to collect what you were due, and they didn't give it to them, we'd be pretty ill about that. Amen? Y'all asleep? Wouldn't you? So he sends another one. He sends another servant. They do the same thing. And Jesus says that he sends numerous people to go and to collect what is his due. And they harmfully treat each and every one of them. And in fact, they kill some of them. Now, this part of the story, everybody that was listening would have been thinking this. Boy, I wouldn't have sent all them people. It's time to do business. It's time to go and demand justice. It's time to go and root out those people and get rid of them and get some more. They've had more than an opportunity to profit off of this, and they're taking advantage of the situation. And yet, what does Jesus say here? Instead of the owner coming in judgment, he says, you know, I have a son. He's my only son. He's my beloved son. They know who he is. They know he's my son. They know that if I send him, surely they will respect him. Surely they will honor him because of who he is. And they will set things right with him. Folks, this is a sign of God's grace. Amen? And yet, Jesus says when the farmers saw his son coming, they said, you know what? We can kill him. If we kill him, then we can just assume control. Some have suggested that in those days that it was possible if the father died and then that owned the property, and then he only had one heir and he died, then whoever was running the property then would just take over everything. And that might have been what they were thinking. But folks, they weren't being faithful to what they had agreed to. They weren't being faithful with what God required of them. And when they saw the son coming, they got greedy and they said, we'll just kill him. And they were disrespectful to him. They beat him. They killed him. And then it says they threw him outside the vineyard, leaving his body exposed to the elements. And then Jesus asked a question. What do you think he's going to do now? He's going to come for judgment. Now, what's the meaning of the parable? It's a simple parable. You've already figured this out. The Jews that heard him, they would have known immediately what was going on. Oftentimes in the Old Testament, especially in the book of Isaiah, God refers to the nation Israel as his vineyard. And he says, I planted you, I watered you, I blessed you, I helped you to flourish. We entered into a covenant relationship where you were to love me and obey me, and I was going to take care of you. We know from Isaiah that Israel was not faithful. Israel did not produce works of righteousness. They did not honor God. They did not point the world to God and to worshiping God. And so when he began this parable, they knew immediately what he was talking about. He's talking about God. He's saying that God planted the nation Israel, and Israel is the vineyard. And the tenant farmers, Those were the religious leaders who were charged with knowing and teaching the law and leading people to God. And instead of leading them to God, they were leading them away from God. And they did not want to do what God's word said. When God sent his servants, who were the servants? His servants were the prophets, those who proclaimed God's word, those who called God's people to be faithful to him, to obey him. And what did they do to those servants? They did not receive them. We've often seen in the Old Testament where some of the prophets of God, like Jeremiah, they were accused of being a false prophet. They were being Jeremiah. They tried to kill Jeremiah on several occasions. They did kill Isaiah. And there were others that were killed and beaten and treated shamefully, even though they came with a message from God. And yet, even though the Jews rejected God and following him and obeying him and rejected his word, God didn't say, okay, that's it. I'm done. I'm through. I'm not going to do this anymore. I'm just going to wipe everybody out. Instead, the Son points to who? The Son points to our precious Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And yet, how were the leaders treating him right now? They didn't accept his authority. They accused him of being of the devil. They said, you're not of God. There's no way. You don't match up with what we think the Messiah is going to be like. And they rejected him. And what are they going to do in just a few days? They're going to kill him. They don't actually kill him, but they come up with a plan, and they take him before Pilate, and they have Pilate give the authority and the word so that his life may be taken. Now, here in this parable, according to the parable, once the son is killed, the owner comes and brings judgment upon those who did not honor and were not faithful. But I want you to notice something here. Notice our story about Jesus doesn't end with the parable. In the parable, the son is killed. The owner comes and judges. That's not the end of the story with Jesus. They kill Jesus, amen? He dies on the cross. But look at what Jesus said. He added to the parable. Verse 10. Have you not read this scripture based out of Psalm? The stone which the builder rejected has become the head of the cornerstone. He's sending a message. He's telling these folks that they're already determined, we got to figure out a way to get rid of this man. And Jesus says, the very one that you are rejecting, me, I am the very foundation of God's plan of salvation for all of mankind. Now the Jews, they thought the way to get rid of Jesus was to kill him. Right? If we just kill him, then we'll get rid of him. We'll solve our problem. But praise be to God, that was part of God's plan, because on the third day, Jesus did die. But on the third day, Jesus rose from the grave. Amen? And he's alive even more. And because he died on the cross and rose from the grave, he is our Lord and Savior, and we can be saved through him. This is all part of God's plan. This is not the end of the story, but only the beginning. Now,
question, though, is, have you trusted Jesus as your Lord and Savior? Have you given him your heart and your life? Because, folks, if you will, he will save you. But there's another aspect of this parable that I want to spend a few minutes on. And that is the issue of stewardship. Before anybody gets nervous, I'm not talking about money here, though that's involved. But these farmers were to be good stewards of the farm that they were entrusted with. But they weren't. They weren't. The Jews were to be stewards of the righteousness of God and obey God and point the world to God. But what did they do? They did everything but that. I was listening to a podcast this week, and they were talking about something going on with a very liberal part of the Jewish faith. And basically they made the comment that this very liberal sect places more value on what their teachers have said over the years instead of what God's Word actually said. They've basically thrown out the Old Testament, which they would only recognize the Old Testament. But they've basically thrown out the Old Testament, and instead they're just winging it. They're just doing what makes sense to them. Folks, are we being a good steward of what God has given us? You know, it's very fashionable today to be critical of others, especially those who are in power or in leadership position. And sadly, we're seeing a lot of times where people are misusing their positions. But folks, it's real easy to point fingers. It's real easy. Folks, I want to ask, are we being a good steward to what we have been given, or are we squandering it, and are we trying to use what God has given us for our benefit, like the Jews did in Jesus' day, and not obeying the Lord and not following Him? Paul said we've been entrusted with the gospel. The gospel. Now, folks, that's not something to. The gospel is not something to receive and then stick it somewhere safe where nobody can get to it, nobody can find it, and we can't remember where we put it. My mother used to give me Christmas presents in June. She would say, "This was your Christmas present from a couple of years ago. I put it up and I just have found it." Folks, the gospel is the good news of Jesus Christ, that Jesus has come to die on the cross to save us from our sins. And if we'll repent, He will save us. And we're to receive it, but it's not enough to receive it. Once we've received it, we've been entrusted with it, and we need to share it with everybody we can. Not just people in our immediate circle, not just people who look like us, not just people that we're comfortable with, but anybody God puts us in the midst of. Are we being faithful with the gospel? I was so tickled yesterday at the egg hunt, Easter egg hunt, because we as a church, I believe, we're demonstrating what it means to be a good steward of the gospel. because many of you and worked hard to invite people to come with children. And then you, when they came, you sat with them, you talked to them, you engaged with them, and you did everything to make them feel comfortable. Folks, that's what the gospel is all about. Amen? We've got to go out and tell people. We've got to invest in other people's lives. We've got to do everything we can to earn the right to share the gospel with them. What are we doing? Now, I'm not a money person. My brother is. But what would we say of somebody who maybe had some money, a little bit of money? And if this is your investment strategy, then I'm not trying to be offensive. But what would we think of somebody who just got that money and put it in a sock and dug a hole in the backyard and left it there for 10, 15, 20 years? Mac told everybody that that's what his daddy did. And you know what Mac said after his daddy died and Jennifer bought the house? He said, "Preacher, I don't think you'll find anything, but if y'all dig up anything, I don't want it. I just want to know if you found something." But folks, what happens if we take money out and we just stick it somewhere and we leave it for 20, 30 years? It depreciates in value because of inflation, right? Y'all wait. Wouldn't that be a mistake? I mean, it'd be a lot better to put it in the bank and get, what, 0.5% interest? Is it up to that now? I don't know. No, but I mean, you know what I'm saying? We'd say that's foolish. Would y'all agree with me there? That's foolish. Well, folks, what are we doing with the gospel? We've been entrusted with the gospel, and we need to share it because, folks, we're looking at it after Jesus came. We know He is the Messiah. We know that He died for our sins. We know that He rose from the grave. We know that He gives eternal life. What are we doing to share the gospel with those that God has put us in the midst of? Who do you know that's lost? Who are you praying for? Who are you investing your life in? And folks, and don't just focus on one person. Sometimes what we do is, there may be somebody and we may be burdened about them. And folks, you need to pray for that person and you need to look for opportunities to share. But folks, sometimes the person that we want to come to faith in Christ the most, they may not hear us. And if we're so focused on that one person, we may miss other people that God brings too. Now, we need to provide a witness for that person. But folks, it may be there are others that will listen. There's some folks in my family that I can't talk to about the Lord. I mean, I can talk to them, but they just turn me off, walk away, won't listen to a thing I say. But you know what? God has placed other people in their lives. And some of those folks will call me and tell me something. Do you know who I sat next to? It was a preacher. And I just smile. Amen. Amen. But then there are other people that I can't. So folks, who are the lost that we can reach to? Who are the lost that will be open? What are we doing? Because folks, if we just sit on the gospel, we are being foolish with the most precious gift we could ever get. Not only are we being a good steward of the gospel, are we being a good steward in serving the Lord through his local church. And by that I mean Union Grove. And I'm emphasizing Union Grove because I'm talking to the people that are here, which is you. Is everybody here? Everybody here that here? You know? And this needs to be said at every church, local church. You know, I've heard for years people say, I love Jesus, I don't love the church. No, you don't love Jesus then. You know? Because Jesus loves the church. And folks, if we're faithful, we need to be a good steward by serving the Lord through his local church. Part of the problem with people that don't love the church is they don't want to be held accountable for how they live their lives. They don't want the church to have responsibility over them. Are we being a good steward? Are we giving the Lord our best? Or are we just doing whatever? Whatever. Folks, we better be giving him more than whatever. Amen? Because what is he giving us? Everything. Everything. He's given us life. He's given us hope. He's given us the Holy Spirit. He's given us an eternal home. He's made God our Father. He's forgiven us of all of our sins. He's applied his righteousness to us. How can we return and just say, whatever? We need to give him our best. Amen? We need to serve him through his local church. This parable, Jesus is using it. He's looking them right in the eye and telling them what they're about to do to him. That would have been something to see. Amen. And not only did he look them in the eyes as he told them, this is what you're going to do to me. They knew that's what they were going to do to him. But in their arrogance, they thought, oh, you know, if we get rid of him, he's gone, he's done. But thanks be to God, God had other plans. And he was the Son of God, and he did rise from the grave, and he is alive even today. How are we responding to what he's given us? Somebody asked me one time why I did everything that I did for my mom and dad when they were dying. And I looked at him and I said, well, what else could I do? I didn't want to say this, but I'm like, I'd be a pretty horrible, sorry son if I wasn't there for them, because they sure were there for me, you know? Folks, we need to be there for the Lord, amen? Because he's definitely there for us. Who do we know that's lost? Who can we share the gospel with? Folks, we live, you know, These are crazy times. We can complain about how things are. But I would encourage you, let's not spend so much time complaining. Let's spend some time praying for the lost. Let's spend some time putting names to the lost. Let's spend some time working to try to get the lost to church. Let's spend some time sharing the gospel with those who are folks, you know what? We don't have to go far, do we? We don't have to go far. They're everywhere. They're everywhere. Somebody had a comment, and I'm going to close with this. One of the commentaries, they had this thought. They said that the tenant farmers were acting as an owner instead of a servant. When it comes to the things of God, are we acting as though we're in charge or that we're a servant of the Lord to do his bidding? Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your love and mercy and goodness to us. The privilege is to be here in this place. Lord, we thank you that you came to this earth. Were born as a baby, took on human flesh, lived as a man, willingly offered your life as a sacrifice for our sins. We thank you for that. But we're also excited that you didn't stay in the grave because you rose from the grave 3 days later. And you are alive even more. Lord, I pray if there's one here today who does not know you as their Lord and Savior, Lord, I pray that they'll trust you today. Lord, I pray if there's one that needs to, maybe they've gotten away from you, Lord, or Lord, you've been working on them to get back with you. They've not been a good steward, Lord, of their faith, of the gospel, Lord. Then help them to get right with you today. Lord, I pray, help us as your people here at Union Grove. Help us to serve you faithfully, be a good steward of this church. Lord, help us to be a good steward of the gospel as we share it with those you've placed us in the midst of. In the precious name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.